الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وعلى كل من تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما اللهم فقهنا في الدين وعلمنا تأويل وبعد. Respected brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. First of all, I would like to thank all of you for coming here today. May Allah reward you, all of you, inshallah, all the brothers and sisters. I would also like to thank and show gratitude to the organizers of today's event, Turath Publishers, Turath Publishing, and Ebrahim College for getting this together, putting this together, and inviting me. It's an honor and it's a privilege to be here. We have many speakers that will be talking about, as you know, the theme of today's event, the legacy of the scholars of the subcontinent, the ulama of the Indian subcontinent. And the various speakers will be talking from different angles, from different backgrounds. We've already heard Sheikh Shams al-Duha speaking. After me, there will be other speakers who will talk about the legacy of the scholars from the Quranic perspective, from the Hadith perspective, and as it was advertised, my concentration will be on the legacy of the scholars in terms of their contribution towards fiqh. This is actually a very vast topic, very important topic. I just have a few points that I want to, inshallah, share with you. Fiqh is actually a very important part of our deen. Jurisprudence, many of you may, well, all of you have heard of fiqh. It's part and parcel of our life. Asasun fi ddeen. There is no movement in our life without fiqh. Fiqh, the laws, the rules, the injunctions of sharia. A human being, man, woman, cannot move without the laws and ahkam of sharia. It relates to every part of our life. Every part, every second, every moment of our life is connected to fiqh. And this fiqh is the understanding of the Qur'an and Sunnah. It's not something which is besides the Qur'an and Sunnah. Fiqh is the understanding of the Qur'an and Sunnah. Basically, fiqh, literally, linguistically, fiqh means to understand. In Arabic, you have faqiha yafqahu, which means to understand. And the one who has this understanding, well, actually in the Arabic language, from the linguistic point of view, you have two sort of words, faqiha yafqahu, and you have faquha yafquhu. There's actually a difference. One is faqiha, which means to have some sort of understanding, basic understanding. Every human being has this faqiha yafqahu, basic understanding of whatever, you know, they have understanding. So if somebody has a basic understanding of something, that is known as faqiha yafqahu, and the one who has that understanding is known as faqih. And then there is another, from the same root word, you have faquha yafquhu, which means someone who has a real deep understanding. And the one who has this deep understanding is known as faqih. And faqih is a jurist. The plural is fuqaha. We've had fuqaha from the time. Well, the first faqih was who? Who was the first faqih? Sayyidul fuqaha, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who better understood the Quran and his own statements than the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He was the first faqih of this ummah. He was Sayyidul fuqaha. Because fiqh basically means to go deep, to understand. To understand the Qur'an and Sunnah is basically what fiqh is. So, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam was the first faqih. But this is not for everyone. That's why when we see the companions, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, how many companions were there? Hundreds and thousands of Sahaba. But from them, as Imam Ibn al-Qayyim puts it, between 120 to 150 fuqaha Sahaba, that's it. Nobody else. Out of the thousands of Sahaba companions. How many? Most of them, and many of them, were relating hadith. They were relating hadith, they were muhaddithun, they were relating hadith, narrators of hadith. Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu was known as the most prolific narrator of hadith. Many of them were relating hadith. But when it came to understanding, going deep into the aspects of the hadith, whether there's, how do you sort of reconcile between contradictory narrations? Is this nasikh? Is this mansukh? Is this the abrogating hadith? Has this been abrogated? What is the deeper meaning of this? What is the literal meaning of this? What is the deeper meaning of this? How do you reconcile between different types of narrations? How do you reconcile between some hadith and Quran? This is all to do with fiqh. So There were only between 120 to 115, 120 to 150, 150, Sahaba, who were known to be the fuqaha. They were deriving laws, they were extracting laws from the Quran and Sunnah. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam in the hadith of Musnad Ahmad, Tirmidhi and elsewhere, he mentioned the virtues of the fuqaha. Remember, those who are not fuqaha, there's also virtues for those kind of Sahaba companions, as well as the later tabi'un and muhadithun, the ones who are just narrating. But specifically for the fuqaha, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, نَضَّرَ اللَّهُ إِمْرَأً سَمِعَ مِنَّا حَدِيثًا فَحَفِظَهُ وَبَلَّغَهُ غَيْرَهُ فَرُبَّ حَامِلِ فِقْهٍ. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam used the word فِقْهٍ, فَرُبَّ حَامِلِ فِقْهٍ لَيْسَ بِفَقِيهٍ. Allah illuminate the person, meaning his face, his heart. Allah illuminate. This is a dua from the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. May Allah illuminate the man who hears a hadith from me, and then he memorizes it, and then he relates it to somebody else. This actually is a dua for the narrator of hadith, the one who just hears it and then relates it to somebody else. And then the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, فَرُبَّ حَامِلِ فِقْهٍ لَيْسَ بِفَقِيهِ. The one sometimes who's relating is actually not a faqih. He just relates the hadith. And in another riwayah, he said, فَرُبَّ مُبَلَّغٍ أَوْعَى مِنْ سَامِعٍ. Sometimes the one whom to whom he relates the hadith to is more understanding of the hadith itself. So there's many virtues. There's a hadith as well in Sahih al-Bukhari, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, مَنْ يُرِدِ اللَّهُ بِهِ خَيْرًا يُفَقِّهُ فِي الدِّينِ. With whomever Allah intends good, Allah gives them him a deep fiqh understanding. مَنْ يُرِدِ اللَّهُ بِهِ خَيْرًا يُفَقِّهُ فِي الدِّينِ. So there's numerous narrations. And as I said, this is not for everybody, because fiqh is very specific. It requires a lot of intelligence, a lot of deep understanding. It requires a lot of effort as well, a lot of time. You know, not a lot of people have time. Fiqh is only for people who have time, who can take up time, seriously. Yes, if you've got a wife who's going to complain, then you can never be a faqih for the brothers. Because you can't. You need a wife who will sacrifice everything, your day and night. Ask the people who are involved in fiqh. They have phone calls coming at 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock sometimes. You have to answer 100, 200 questions per week. I'm not saying month. 100, 200 questions per week. Seriously. So this is not for everybody. This fiqh is very it requires a lot of effort. And that's why there were certain companions who were, radiallahu anhum, who were from the thousands, who are known to be fuqaha. And then from them the tabi'un, and then the great tabi'een after them. And he carried on, and he carried on through the centuries, through the eras, and it came to the Indian subcontinent. In the subcontinent, alhamdulillah, Allah blessed the subcontinent with many great fuqaha and many great scholars in different sciences, but especially in fiqh. When it came to fiqh, we'll hear the other speakers talking about hadith and Quran, but I just want to talk about some brief points, and based on those points, I will give you some examples, some important features or salient features, or some important features in terms of the contribution of the scholars of the Indian subcontinent when it came to fiqh. Number one, as you know, remember these are numbers, points that I'm going to mention to you. Time is very short. I have like about 10-12 points, but I don't know if I'll be able to get through all 10-12. The first point is that, as you know, the scholars of the subcontinent were Hanafi. Most of the Muslims in the subcontinent are Hanafi. There are some Shafi'i. So they were deeply rooted in Hanafi fiqh. They were deeply rooted in Hanafi fiqh. However, one of the characteristics of the ulama and the fuqaha of the subcontinent is that even though they were deeply rooted in the fiqh of Al-Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu anhu, their fiqh was nusus and text oriented, as opposed to some other Hanafis in other parts of the world. For example, if you go to Turkey or you go to Syria, I stayed 2 years in Syria, I studied there. You could see a big difference between the fuqaha of Syria and the fuqaha of the subcontinent. In Turkey, which I visited recently, you will find they are very, very much text-based in terms, very much fiqh text-based. Whereas in the Hanaf, the scholars of the subcontinent, you will see big, and the reason for this is that the scholars of the subcontinent have always had a lot of deep connection with hadith. As one of the speakers will speak about, you know, the connection, the ulum, the knowledge of the science of hadith moved from the Arab world in the last 14th, in the last century, the Islamic Hijri calendar 14th century, it moved to the subcontinent. Sheikh Abdul Fattah Abu Ghudda rahimahullah used to say that the knowledge of hadith moved from the Arab world, and in the last century it moved to the Indian lands. And this is why we see that in the recent 100 years, great scholars like Al-Imam Anwar Shah Kashmiri rahimahullah, he wrote a commentary on Sahih al-Bukhari. We have Sheikh Khalil Ahmad Sahranpuri rahimahullah writing a commentary 20 volumes on the Sunan of Abi Dawood. You have Sheikh Zakaria al-Kandalawi rahimahullah writing Awjaz al-Masalik, 16 volumes commentary on the Muwatta of Imam Malik. You have Sheikh Shabbir Ahmad Uthmani writing commentary on Sahih Muslim, and our Sheikh Mufti Taqi Uthmani also writing the completion of that in Arabic, which is quite significant. There's nobody, Allahu A'lam, according to my knowledge right now, living in the world today, who has an Arabic commentary on one of the major 6 books of hadith throughout the world, except Sheikh Taqi Uthmani. But anyway, these were great scholars in the last 100 years who contributed to the science of hadith. Now, when they have contributed to the science of hadith, it's going to affect their fiqh, without a doubt. Even Quran, they wrote books, Ma'arif al-Quran, Ahkam al-Quran. So despite being text, you know, very much solid in the Hanafi madhab, they were very much Quran and Sunnah based as well. I don't know if you understand what that means, but anyway, those who understand, they understand. And that's why we'll find that a lot of the fiqh of the subcontinent scholars is found in their hadith commentaries. So you'll find Sheikh Zakaria rahimahullah writing a commentary on the Muwatta of Imam Malik, and he'll tell you Abu Hanifa says this, Shafi'i says this, Malik says this, Ahmad bin Hanbal says this, and Abu Hanifa's dalil is this, 1, 2, 3, 4. You'll find, you know, the commentary of Imam al-Kashmiri rahimahullah on Sahih al-Bukhari, Faidul Bari, and he'll mention the evidences of the Hanafi madhab. And the most monumental classic work, this is a colossal work, 20 volume work, compendium of Hanafi proofs, written by Sheikh Ghaffar Ahmed Uthmani Atanwi rahimahullah, the nephew of Hakim al-Umma Mawlana Shafi Atanwi rahimahullah, 20 volumes in Arabic, all the proofs of the Hanafi madhab from the beginning till end, proofs from the hadith and from the sahaba, from the statements and the athar of sahaba radiallahu anhu. It's printed, it's available. The first volume actually was then printed and sort of edited by Mufti Taqi Uthmani, Sheikh Abdul Fattah Abu Ghudda rahimahullah. He published the introduction of that book in a separate book in the Arab world, and this is taught. When I was in Syria, this was actually one of the sheikhs down there used to actually teach this book to the students. 20 volumes, I'la'u sunan. This was written by who? Sheikh Ghaffar Ahmed Uthmani, the nephew of Hakim al-Ummah, al-Sheikh Mawlana Ashraf Ali Thanvi rahimahullah, under the guidance of Hakim al-Ummah, al-Sheikh Mawlana Ashraf Ali Thanvi rahimahullah, under his guidance, under his leadership, under his sort of dictation. And this is a colossal, monumental 20-volume compendium of Hanafi madhab proofs. Like, you know, this is the reason why this was compiled. Sheikh Ashraf Ali Thanvi rahimahullah felt that people like today, they are raising their voices against the madhabs, that look, these madhabs are based on weak proofs or this or that, brother, akhi, hadith, weak, whatever. So therefore he thought it's very much needed that the proofs of the madhab be gathered, and, you know, strong proofs. So he gathered, these were gathered, and this was the whole reason for it. So he ordered his nephew to do this. So you have this is one of the very important features of the Hanafi, the scholars of the subcontinent, the fuqaha of the subcontinent. Number two, when it came to following a madhab, the scholars of the subcontinent, their methodology, their maslak or their understanding was that yes, we follow one imam, that's it, taqleed shakhsi. This is another topic. I don't want to go into this topic of taqleed, mutlaq, shakhsi, whatever. But we restrict ourselves to one imam as much as possible. Okay? And moving out from the madhab, that today we follow the Shafi'i madhab, tomorrow we follow the Maliki, and then the next day we follow a Hanbali, morning I'm a Hanafi, afternoon I'm a Shafi'i, in the evening I've got 4 wives. Yeah? This was something that they did not entertain, and they were quite strict on, as opposed to some other Hanafi fuqaha of other parts of the world. If you, for example, go to Syria, and I stayed there as I told you, people were, the scholars, some of my teachers were very relaxed. It's okay, take a rukhsa. You know, the Maliki say this, take a rukhsa from here, Shafi'i, Maliki, Hanbali. But, and the reason for this is that originally it's not haram. Because we say all four are correct. They are all four understandings of the Quran and Sunnah. They are all four different approaches, explanations, interpretations of the Quran and Sunnah. And everyone did their ijtihad, and Allah will accept all four. It's just the understanding of thousands of scholars over thousands of years for each of the madhabs. So, therefore, originally it's not a problem, it's permissible. However, because of the reason, because of the fact that if we give this open sort of leeway, what will happen is that people will start following their own desires. Ittiba'ul hawa. And this is why, like Sheikh Mahmoud al-Hassan al-Dawbandi, Sheikh Zakaria al-Kandahlawi rahimahullah, both of them stated that this is not a Islamic Shari'i ruling that you have to stick to one. It's actually a sort of, it's a fatwa given in order to stop people from following their desires, because people will start taking easy rules which the Quran condemns. اتِّبَاعُ الْهَوَىٰ أَفَرَأَيْتَ مَنِ اتَّخَذَ إِلَهَهُ هَوَىٰ. However, there are certain cases in which this could be permissible. So therefore, it's not like absolutely haram, but in certain cases. But there are strict conditions. So the fuqaha of the subcontinent, they were very, very particular about the strict conditions. Only when there's, like, for example, genuine hardship, umum balwa, or haja shadida, extreme need, or widespread need, only then. And they put conditions down. So it's like for example, I'll give you an example. In the Hanafi madhab, a woman who's, this was the original ruling, whose husband goes missing, imra'atul mafqood. Mafqood is the one who's gone missing. You know what the original ruling is? That she has to keep waiting. Waiting until a time comes that it's sort of presumed that all his friends have died, the husband's friends have all died. So like, you know, when you presume now the husband's reached about 80, 90, Mawtul Aqran, or about 80, 90 years of age, then that's when then the Qadi, the judge, will say, okay, now we think most likely your husband's dead. You've been waiting for him for 40 years. He's not going to come back. Now he's probably dead. Now you do the iddah. Now your nikah is fasq. And that 85-year-old buddhi, old woman, you know, is going to get married, mashallah. This is original Hanafi madhab viewpoint. So the scholars, later Hanafi scholars in the subcontinent as well, like Hakim al-Ummah, rahimahullah, wrote a book. Especially, not just this particular issue, but many issues that were relating to women finding difficulty, hardship. Some women were leaving Islam. So he actually compiled a whole book, Al-Hilatu Najiza Lil-Mar'ati Al-Ajiza. You know, specific book for ways out for a woman. Is it better? And he actually approached the Maliki madhab, the scholars, and he gave fatwa that the Hanafis in this particular matter need to follow the Maliki madhab. Is it better to follow the Maliki madhab or become a murtad and leave Islam? Of course. So, in certain extreme hardship cases, they did say, yes, we have to follow, you know, we must follow the Hanafi madhab, but in cases, if there's a genuine need, widespread need, hardship, then what will happen? We will give the ruling and allow people to follow another madhab. But at the same time, other conditions, the one who's doing that must consult the great scholars of the other madhab. When Hakim al-Ummah rahimahullah was writing this book, he consulted with the top Maliki scholars from Mecca and Medina. And also, one or two other kind of conditions they put, like for example, talfiq, which is when you make a combination of two madhabs, which is not allowed according to anybody, right? That's another issue I don't have time to go into, but that's another sort of ruling or another condition they put. Number three, the third point, the third khususiyah or specific distinctive feature of the fuqaha, the jurists of the subcontinent, is that they put a lot of emphasis on a person acquiring proper training before he sits on the position of giving religious verdicts and rulings and giving fatwa. Today we live in a time, everyone's an expert except the experts. Everyone's been a mujtahid, everybody has an opinion. These people were very particular, very particular. They said this is a science. It's not for any Tom, Dick and Harry, or kullu man habba wa dab, like they say in Arabic. Not everyone's job to start giving fatwas and religious verdicts. Until a person does not spend time under the guidance and does not undergo training under the guidance of a, you know, expert faqih, he is banned. It is haram. Even earlier scholars said this. Khatib al-Baghdadi mentioned this in his Al-Faqih wal-Mutafaqih. So this was something that they really emphasized upon. You know what Imam Malik said? Ma aftaytu. I never gave a fatwa. A fatwa doesn't just mean like an official fatwa, but even telling someone a legal verdict. Hatta shahida li sab'una man huwa a'lamu minni bi anni ahlun li dhalik. Until 70 people who are more knowledgeable than me gave testimony that I am worthy of giving a fatwa. Imam Malik. How many people? 70. And you know these 70 people? What kind of people? Mufti Taqi Uthmani, when he was telling this, teaching us this in class, he said, remember, don't look at the number 70, look at man huwa a'lamu minni. 70 people above me, not below me. You know, people under you can all tell you, mashallah, you're the greatest sheikh. You know, on Facebook, they'll all like you. Mashallah, you're amazing sheikh. Doesn't matter, it doesn't do anything. But if your teachers, if people above you, if they say yes, you are great, then this is an indication, inshallah, that according to Allah, you are, you know, you have something. So, therefore, they were very particular about this. And that's why, you know, the titles as well of Mufti, Sheikh, I mean, I remember when we were studying in Darul Karachi, I studied with Mufti Taqi Uthmani in 99, around that time. 98, 99, 2000. He used to tell us that, you know, when younger students in the second, third, fourth, fifth year, if they start calling you Mufti Sahab, because get angry, tell them, why are you calling Mufti? Even till today, there are scholars who are Muftis, some of my teachers. One of them was Mufti Mahmud Ashraf Uthmani, Hafidhahullah. He's actually the nephew of Mufti Taqi Uthmani, but he's about 60 years in age. Just 5 years ago, he got an official title, Mufti, after 25 years of proper work in the Darul Ifta of Darul Ulum Karachi. Until now, he was a Mawlana or just Mahmud Ashraf. 25 years under the guidance of Mufti Taqi, Mufti Rafi Uthmani. That's when you get the title Mufti. This is the time we're living in. There's just this bankruptcy in knowledge when it comes to knowledge. You know, the ones who are really, you know, the ones who are not Mufti like me, you know, have these titles. And it's just, it's very sad. So, Hassan al-Basri, somebody said to him, Ya Faqih, O Faqih. So he looked at him. He said, Awahal ra'ayta faqihan qat. Have you ever seen a faqih that you're calling me a faqih? Have you ever seen a faqih before? He took out the nisbah. I'm not a faqih. So, this is why this was something that the ulama of the subcontinent really focused on. Mufti Taqi Uthmani, Shaykh al-Islam, Shaykh Mufti Taqi Uthmani, Hafidhahullah, what he mentions in one of the books, he said that, you know, when we were students, and this was like when we were towards the end of our years when we were studying, nearly becoming an alim, when we used to be at home, his father was the Grand Mufti of Pakistan, Mufti Shafi Rahimahullah. People used to phone him. He said, we used to pick up the phone, listen to the question, and relate it to our father. Our father never even used to rely on what? On our listening to the question. He will take the phone and then listen again himself and then respond. And then he said, after that, when he, after a few years, when he became a bit sort of satisfied, then he said, okay, tell me what the question is, and then he would respond, and then they would relate it. He said, one day somebody asked, it was a simple talaq issue. So he said to himself, look, my father, why bother him? It was simple, yeah, talaq's done. So he told the person, yes, talaq is done. So when his father came back from upstairs, he said, yeah, somebody's phone came and I told him. So he said, your father looked at me. He said, khair. You gave the right answer, but never ever do that again. Never ever do that again. And then he said, since that day, we had a lesson. We will never do that. Afterward, he told us, now, you know, small questions, easy questions, just answer them yourselves. He said, even that we never used to do because we were, that in the beginning, the tarbiyah of his father. You know, considering yourself to be someone who's not, worthy. So, this was one of the very important sort of features of the fuqaha of the subcontinent, that they would put a lot of emphasis on tarbiyah, staying in the company, suhbah. This is not just a tasawwuf type of tarbiyah, this is staying in the company of a qualified or a few qualified. Every single faqih that came, every single faqih or a mufti of the subcontinent, they've had proper training. At least one or two or three great fuqaha. They spent 5, 6, 7 years. Even afterwards, they carry on. You have to always keep in connection with the people above you. One of the other, number four, was that they would put a lot of emphasis on coming to conclusions in terms of not having personal opinions, but whenever there's a new, especially when there are contemporary issues, new issues, important issues, then they would get together and a communal type of gathering would take place. So not everyone's individual, that I think, okay, this is the ruling, I say, this is halal, this is haram, this is a fatwa. People would get together, it would be done ijtima'an. You know, it would be done ijtima'an. And that's what we have, like for example, right now we have in the Indian subcontinent, we have Majma'ul Fiqh al-Islami, the Islamic Fiqh Academy of India. We have the same one in Jeddah. Mufti Muhammad Shafi'i rahimahullah, he assembled a majlis known as Majlis Tahqiq Masa'il Hadira, you know, contemporary issues. So, and they would, you know, get together, collectively sort of come to conclusion. And this is taken from a hadith, Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu anhu. He once asked the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah, إن نزل بنا أمر ليس فيه بيان أمر ونهي فماذا تأمرنا? If we don't have explicit أمر and نهي, command and prohibition from you, what should we do? So the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, شاوروا الفقهاء العابدين. Consult the fuqaha and who are the worshippers, who are righteous. Hadith related by Imam al-Tabrani, and it's considered to be sahih. Number five was that they would really put emphasis on increasing the knowledge, especially tafaqquh, understanding the fiqh, going deep. Okay, a lot of emphasis on this. And for a student or for an alim, for a graduate to carry on studying, increasing his understanding of the Quran and Sunnah, increasing his tafaqquh. And there were certain, like we have stories like Mufti Taqi Usmani, for example, the story about him that he used to, in holiday times, he'd tell the librarian to lock the door from outside and lock him up in the library for 6-7 hours when he was 16, 17, 18 years of age. And there are many, many examples like that. There's a title, we say faqih, but there's another title known as faqihun nafs. Faqihun nafs, according to the terminology of the fuqaha of the world, is a person who, after going through so much deep sort of relationship with fiqh, and because of long tajrabah and experience, his nature becomes fiqh. This happens in all sciences, you know, different, even a doctor, sometimes a doctor with so long sort of experience, after a lengthy experience, it's like sometimes he doesn't need to really sort of return back to the books. There were some people like that. Sheikh Anwar Shah al-Kashmiri, al-Imam Anwar Shah al-Kashmiri rahimahullah, he used to say that from the subcontinent we had Imam Rashid Ahmad Gangohi, who was known as Faqihun Nafs. He used to say Imam Ibn Abidin is not Faqihun Nafs, who was the famous Hanafi scholar from Syria. And he said Ibn Nujaym was Faqihun Nafs. One of the great people like this was Mufti Muhammad Shafi' al-Uthmani, the father of Mufti Taqi Uthmani rahimahullah, known as Faqihun Nafs. Some of you may have heard the name of Imam Muhammad Zahid al-Kawthari. Yeah? Have you heard of Imam Muhammad Zahid al-Kawthari? Mufti Taqi Uthmani calls him the Anwar Shah al-Kashmiri of Egypt. He was a Hanafi. He once wrote a letter to Mufti Muhammad Shafi rahimahullah. And in that letter, you know, he wrote long, long titles. He said, إِلَى حَضْرَةِ أَخِينَا فِي اللَّهِ الْعَلَّامَ الْمُحَدِّثَ الْفَقِيهِ الْمُفْتِي مُحَمَّد شَفِيعَ الدَّوْبَنْدِي حَفِظَهُ اللَّهِ etc. etc. And then after that he said, وَقَدْ طَالَتْ مُمَارَسَتُكُمْ طَالَتْ مُمَارَسَتُكُمْ Your experience has become very long. حَتَّى أَصْبَحْتَ فَقِيهَ النَّفْسِ بِالْمَعْنَى الصَّحِيحِ You have become faqihun nafs in the true meaning of the word. That's you. You have the title faqihun nafs. Faqihun nafs meaning that your whole body, your nature, your blood, you know, is fiqh, basically. You sleep fiqh, you eat fiqh, you drink fiqh. You don't need to refer to books sometimes. Your nature will tell you. There's a story which I heard directly from Mufti Taqi Uthmani about his father, that once there were great scholars, him, his brother, Sheikh Yusuf bin Nuri, and you know that assembly that used to gather to deliberate on and discuss Islamic new issues. He said, one day we sat from morning till Asr. There was a new issue that came up. And we discussed at Asr, everybody sort of, and he said his father was the head of the majlis, but that day his father couldn't come because he was ill, so he excused himself. He said, you guys do the discussion. At Asr time, we all sort of came to conclusion, this is the fatwa, this is the ruling, this is the verdict, alhamdulillah, everyone. After Asr, I went to my father, he said, we've all come to this conclusion. His father was in his, you know, bed, he was quite sick. He said, what did you come to a conclusion? He said, we came to this conclusion. He said, no, it doesn't sound right. He said, why? He said, it just doesn't sound right. I don't feel that's right. You know, check again. He said, we've checked all the books. Mufti Rashid Ahmed al-Diyani, Mufti Wali Hassan Sheikh Yusuf bin Nuri, top fuqaha of Pakistan at that time, of Karachi. And he says, no, I just don't feel right. It just doesn't feel right. So he said, okay, we'll check next day. Next day they check again. Halfway through the day, the whole majlis is sitting, they're all deliberating, books and books from the Quran, tafsirs and hadith commentaries and all the fiqh books of the Hanafi madhab. Says something, maybe he's ill. But then he went to him again, he said, I just don't feel right. He said, you guys all want to gather and agree, you sign, but I won't sign. So then they said, there must be something wrong. So then what they did was, they said, okay, they decided that everyone go back home tonight and think on their own in their room, tomorrow we'll come back. When they came back next day, they really found out they were understanding completely opposite to what they were come to a conclusion for 2 days. Despite seeing the books and him on his bed, his just nature told him that this was not the right conclusion. This is what you call a faqihun nafs. This happens in hadith as well. Some people just literally hearing a hadith, they could tell if a hadith is sahih, if a hadith is hasan, if a hadith is mawdu'. That's why they said, inna lil hadithi dhaw'an ka dhaw'in nahari ta'rifuhu. Sometimes a hadith has a light, nur, like the light of the day, you can see it, recognize it when someone is relating the hadith. Wa inna lil hadithi dhalaman ka dhalamin layli tunkiruhu. Sometimes someone relates a hadith, you can see the darkness, you can recognize this is not a hadith. So anyway, this was something that they really focused on. And then also, next point is that they were very, very sort of mutawadi'. They used to be very firm on their stance, but they never used to look down on people. They were very mutawadi', very humble, humility, but very firm. They would be firm, but at the same time humble. There's incidents regarding this as well, subhanAllah, so many things. But you see, even with people of difference of opinion, they were gentle. They were gentle. That doesn't mean they changed their opinions. They wouldn't stand for something which they considered to be incorrect, but they were gentle. They were gentle. Once in the presence of Sheikh Mawlana Ashraf Ali Thanvi rahimahullah, somebody said, Ahmad Rida Khan Barelvi. He said, why didn't you say Mawlana? He's a Mawlana, despite we having many, many differences. Call him a Mawlana, he's an alim. SubhanAllah, just imagine, this is Hakim al-Ummah, regarding whom this Sheikh Ahmad Rida Khan, what did he do? He said, he's a kafir. Somebody called you, me, and kafir, what will you say? You and your dad is kafir as well. SubhanAllah, just imagine, I mean, this is something to recognize and realize. The way they was firm, they wouldn't change their stance. They wouldn't change their stance, but they were gentle. Mufti Muhammad Shafi' rahimahullah, the father of Mufti Taqi Uthmani, he used to always say to the scholars, don't be a sword, be what? Silk. Don't be a sword on people, be a silk. You know why silk? People touch you, you're soft, but nobody can break you. They can't waver, you won't move from your position. I am on the haq, I will stay, but you're soft. This is the balance, to create the balance between the two. Shaykh al-Hind, Mawlana Mahmud al-Hassan Deobandi rahimahullah, once he went to a gathering, people said to him, give a talk. He said, look, I'm not worthy of giving a talk. There's ulama here, how can I speak? So people insisted, you have to, Shaykh, you have to speak, you have to. He said, okay, if I make any mistakes, please tell me, I don't know anything. This is Shaykh al-Hind, you know, one of the greatest scholars of the Deobandi ulama. So he started his talk and he said, فَقِيهٌ وَاحِدٌ أَشَدُّ عَلَى شَيْطَانِ مِنْ أَلْفِ عَابِدٍ. He read the hadith and he started translating. He said, one faqih is more difficult on a abid, on the shaitan, than thousands of worshippers. So somebody stood up, he said, Mawlana. He said, yes, wrong translation. أَشَدُّ is not more difficult, it's more disliked. So first he said, oh, I told you before I'm going to make mistakes. I'm not ahl, I'm so sorry, astaghfirullah. First he said, no, he said, you made a mistake. So he said, sorry, you know, astaghfirullah, I must have made a mistake. You know, I told you, don't tell me to give a talk. I'm not knowledgeable. Then he said, yes, okay, what's the correct meaning, brother? So the brother told him, he gave a wrong meaning. So the sheikh said, no, that meaning is wrong. And then he told him that, look, there's another hadith. And then he gave him an example, explained to him, and then he agreed that, yes, what he was saying was right. In the beginning, he said, sorry, I made a mistake. But when he said something wrong, straight away, he corrected him. This is the balance. Don't be a sword, be silk. People touch you, you have tawadu, you have humility, you have gentleness. But at the same time, this is why in war, the armory was made of what? Silk. Because, another sword would just, it would slide. It would slide on it. You weren't able to break it. Anyway, and there's just one or two other points as well, but I'm just going to put them all together. They used to be very particular about staying away from those kind of issues that create fitna. Those issues that create fitna. Like, for example, people sometimes like to ask questions. What about our Imam of the Masjid? He does this, 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 this. Mufti Taqi Uthmani says, whenever you get a question like that, you know what you should do? Just say, tell the Imam to ask himself. It's not your job. Mufti Muhammad Shafi, rahimahullah, when people used to ask him questions where he would think people want to create fitna, it's not about amal, it's theoretical type of questions. About, you know, how many people were in the grave and the number of people of Ashabul Kahf, or, you know, Khadir alayhi salatu wasalam, is he alive or not? You know, these kind of theoretical questions. You know what he would say? Answer. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, answer. Min husni islam al-mar'i tarkuhu ma la ya'ni. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, from the goodness of a man's religion is to leave that which does not concern you. Things that will not be asked about on the Day of Judgment. People, we live in a time right now that people like to debate and argue about these kind of issues. Somebody asked once Mufti Shafi rahimahullah, is Zaid, Yazid, is he fasiq or not? He said, I don't know about him, I'm worried about myself, am I fasiq or not? You know, I don't know if I'll be forgiven or not, forget about him. So, therefore, these kind of theoretical questions, those that you know, create fitna, they really avoided that. They were very, very particular about that. And then, also finally, last point, there's this one innovative work where the scholars of the subcontinent, they compiled, or their answers, question answers, have been compiled over many large volumes. And this you will not find anywhere, even in the Arab world. This is a recent discovery of the last century. You know, like, in, even in Arabic, that's why I had some friends, you know, when we used to answer questions, some friends from the Arab world, from Jordan, elsewhere, they say to me that you're fortunate you can understand, Hanafi friends, or Syria, elsewhere, you know Urdu because you can directly refer to these books which are in Urdu, because we don't have that even in the Arabic language. Fatawa books. This you will not find, maybe one or two, but literally volumes of books from the beginning, from, you know, purity and tahara and salat and zakat and hajj all the way to the end, question answer with evidences, with proofs. This is the contribution, the greatest probably contribution of the ulama, the fuqaha of the Indian subcontinent. I have a whole list. I have actually written an article which is online somewhere on my website, but there's a whole list of books. Like, for example, you have Fatawa Mahmudiyya. Sheikh Mufti Mahmud al-Hasan Gangohi rahimahullah, great! He was the Mufti of 40 years of Dar al-Ulum Deoband, one of the great. We, alhamdulillah, managed to see him in 1996. We actually took ijazah of hadith from him when studying in Dar al-Ulum Bari. This Mufti Mahmud al-Hasan Gangohi, 20 volumes. You find today his fiqh and his fatawa, 20 volumes, amazing. Amazing collection. Imdadul Fatawa, Sheikh Mawlana Ashraf Al-Itanwi rahimahullah. Amazing, 6 volumes. You have Ahsanul Fatawa, Mufti Rashid Ahmed Ludianwi, about 8 volumes. I can't talk about these, I'm just listing them because I'm ending in 1 minute. Each one requires like 3-4 minutes, but you know. You have Fatawa Rahimiyya, 8-10 volumes. We have Imdadul Muftin, Mufti Muhammad Shafi rahimahullah. We have Kifayatul Mufti, Mufti Kifayatullah Dahlawi, about 10 volumes. Fatawa Khaliliya, 1 volume, Sheikh Khalil Ahmed al-Sahrampuri. We have Khairul Fatawa, which was from Khairul Madaris in Pakistan, 4 volumes so far. You have also, what else did I mention? Imdadul Ahkam, Sheikh Zafar Ahmed Uthmani, the same one who wrote I'la'u Sunan. These are in 4 volumes. Some are in 8, some are in 10, some are in 12 volumes, collection of Q&A. And finally, well, before I say the finally, everyone's household, every household has, this is not really Q&A, but I cannot end this, you know, without mentioning Beheshti Zewar, Heavenly Ornaments of Hakim al-Ummah, al-Sheikh Mawlana al-Shalitani, rahimahullah. And before I do the final one, we have Fatawa Uthmani. You know Fatawa Uthmani? Fatawa Uthmani is the fatawa of our respected guest who's coming today, Sheikh Mufti Taqi Uthmani hafidhahullah. 3 volumes have come out. I asked him on Thursday about the fourth. He said fourth, more or less done, will be released very, very soon in a few weeks' time. And inshallah, more and more as well. I mean, there's so much to say, but I'm going to end this on this because my time stops at 4 o'clock. We need to stick to time because we have great speakers, much better than me. And, you know, they need to speak as well. Jazakallah khair for listening. Barakallah fikum. Assalamu alaikum.